Some years back, a friend of mine was invited to teach at a Bible study in New Jersey. He's a kind of eccentric guy. He's humorous, he's eccentric, and he loves Reformed soteriology. He's a friend, and as we were there, we went there many years ago, and as people were coming in and taking their seats, he had this little booklet, and he handed me this little booklet, and he said, "I think you might be interested in this." So I don't know about you, but when somebody hands me a book, and especially if they say something like that, immediately I start to flip through the pages. So he hands me this book. It was titled something like Everything Man Has Learned from History. So as he gives it to me, I begin to flip through the pages, and I quickly come to find out it's blank. It's all blank. That was the joke of the book. Everything Man Has Learned from History, a blank book. And my friend, in his eccentric kind of humorous way, I don't know if I'm imagining this or I'm recalling this, but I was thinking about it. I remember him doing something like this, like slapping his hand and letting out a short laugh and a loud laugh, because he got me, and he got some other people with that as he was walking around. Not that that was like a crowd warmer. I think he found the book at the place where we were doing the Bible study and just thought it would be kind of funny to pass around. But you get the point that is illustrated in that. The point that is illustrated in that joke is that typically, in so many ways, man is prone to forget the past, and then, as one saying goes, doomed, perhaps better said, prone to repeat it. And in many ways, what we're going to read about today was a reenactment of history. It's different. But in a certain sense, not completely, but in a certain sense, it was kind of like history was repeating itself. You could say that if the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the people who follow them were true theologians, they would have been better historians. Because in so many ways, they were walking in the dreadful footsteps of their fathers who rejected the prophets. And now, suddenly, it appears that history is repeating itself, only with different Israelites, a different pagan nation, and a much worse crime. And before we get there, as we come into our study of the Olivet Discourse once again this morning, we're going to see yet another prediction of Jesus saying that Jerusalem was going to be destroyed. The most recent came in Luke chapter 19, verses 43 and 44. I will quote that to you a little bit later on in the message. But to bring us up to speed, this whole discourse began because Jesus' disciples were with him on the Mount of Olives, and they said they're looking at the temple. They just left the temple, and then they're looking at the temple. They see the beautiful stones. They see the votive offerings, the devoted gifts, and they call Jesus' attention to it, and he calls their attention to the fact that not one stone is going to be left upon another. And that prompts the disciples of Jesus to ask some specific questions, which I'll get to in a moment. Jesus then goes on, before he answers their questions, he tells them about some things that are going to happen before. First, he tells them in verse 8 of Luke chapter 21 that false Christs were going to come. They were going to come in his name. And then he tells them in verse 9 that they would hear of wars and uprisings. And they would hear of nation rising up against nation and kingdom against kingdom. Goes on in verses 10 and 11. He talks about great earthquakes in various places and famines and pestilences and fearful sights and great signs from heaven. But then he said, before all these things, which he said, after he said those things, he said, this is not the end. When you see all these things happening, this is not the end. The end is not yet. And we've argued that those signs that he mentioned that I just listed to you, they were signs that occurred in some measure before 70 AD. But they are also characteristic marks of the period between Jesus' ascension and his second coming. We take a both-and approach to that. Pre-70 AD, leading up to it, and also marks of the post-ascension and pre-return time of Christ. But then he said, before all these things happen, even before those things, which aren't the end's not coming immediately, before all those things, you are going to experience persecution. But Jesus gives his disciples instructions and comfort, and we saw that in two messages as we studied verses 12 through 19. That leads us right up until this text. And Jesus will address the questions that his disciples asked in Luke's gospel. So we begin this morning in Luke chapter 21, verse 20, where we read, "But when you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, then know that its desolation is near." Okay, the first question that we want to ask here is who is the you that is spoken to here? Is it the disciples? Or, as some would suggest, is it a prophetic you? Is it Jesus isn't speaking to his disciples at this point? He's speaking prophetically, like his disciples are hearing them, but he's speaking past them to a future generation. I would argue, I think the most natural reading of this text, particularly in Luke's gospel, you'll see why I emphasize that shortly. Imagining if you were the first reader of this gospel, the intended first reader, Theophilus, I would say Jesus was speaking to his disciples and answering their previously asked questions. Now, staying within the context of Luke's gospel, we see that Luke recorded two of the questions that the disciples asked Jesus after Jesus said that the beautiful stones of the temple would be thrown down and not left standing one upon another. They said, "Teacher," this is verse 7 of Luke 21, "Teacher, but when will these things be, and what sign will there be when these things are about to take place?" So they asked him specifically about the temple. When are those things going to be, and when is that going to take place? And if you notice in Jesus' answer in verses 8 through 21, or 8 through 19, he doesn't immediately answer their question. He tells them about false Christs, he tells them about these signs, he tells them what's going to happen before that. But now when we come to verse 20, he answers their question. He says in verse 20, "But when you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, then know that its desolation is near." Now you might be thinking, well, why are we even asking that question? Come on, really, all that exegesis for who is Jesus speaking to? He's clearly speaking to his disciples. Well, if you ask a second question, you can see why I asked the first question. The second question is this: what about Matthew and Mark's gospel? Because when you look in Matthew and Mark's gospel, there are good reasons to believe that Jesus was speaking past 70 AD. See, whereas Luke writes that the sign that his disciples ought to look for, the sign that Jesus' disciples ought to look for, is when you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, then know that its desolation is near, Matthew and Mark write, "So when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet standing where it ought not, let the reader understand." Now, not only is the sign different, the sign is different here, but also you can note the inspired editorial note that Matthew and Mark include, "Let the reader understand," as though perhaps this is what's written in Matthew and Mark, this wasn't just intended for his disciples. No, in the whole breadth of the discourse, they heard it. "But let the reader understand." This is pointing past the original hearers in a unique way, and it's pointing to the readers in a unique way. Let the reader understand. The abomination of desolation is a term that comes from the book of Daniel. It's referenced three times in Daniel. Daniel chapter 9, verse 27, chapter 11, verse 31, chapter 12, verse 11. And in chapter 11, it clearly refers to Antiochus Epiphanes, a Greek ruler who, in 168 BC, raided the Jewish temple. He desecrated the altar by sacrificing a swine upon it, and he sought to impose false pagan worship. But the reference in Daniel chapter 9 and the reference in Daniel chapter 12, I would argue, refers most likely to the Antichrist, the final world ruler who will oppose the things of God and oppose Christ. In the book of Revelation, he's referred to as the beast. Paul refers to him in 2 Thessalonians as the man of lawlessness. The Apostle John in his first epistle calls him the Antichrist. You have heard that Antichrist is coming, and even now many Antichrists have come. So he is one that is preceded by many. I would argue that he is the one who is standing there. Now it's interesting because the term, the abomination of desolation, that term, when you look at it, Matthew's gospel, Mark's gospel, it's neuter. And I'll say why that's important in a moment. But when you see the verb that follows not too long after, standing where he ought not, that verb is masculine, which I think suggests that the abomination in this case is a person. When you see the abomination of desolation standing where, better said, he ought not. And that would tie in with 2 Thessalonians 2, where Paul talks about this man who opposes all that is called, all that is exalted of God, all that's called God or worshipped. He exalts himself above that, and he calls himself God. We know when we look in Revelation 13, it appears that he will have an idol set up of himself as well. He appears to be, in some measure, the abomination that causes desolation. And in Matthew and Mark's gospel, the argument is, when you see this, when you see that, the abomination that causes desolation, spoken of by the prophet Daniel, then you are to flee, then you are to get out. Now, this is why this is important to understand, because some would say, I think that abomination of desolation is actually the Roman end signs. I think what's actually happening here, it's when the Romans storm the city of Jerusalem, and they put their stakes down, first some would say, in Jerusalem, in the Holy Land. Well, that doesn't tie in with the example of the abomination of desolation, because when Antiochus Epiphanes did it, it wasn't just that he was in the land, it was in the temple. And the other examples that we have of that kind of language would be temple language in the New Testament. So I don't think we can just say it was when the Roman ensigns, their idolatrous images, were in the land. But then some would say, no, it's when the Romans in 70 AD sacked the temple. That's the abomination of desolation. And then they went into the holy place and they put their Roman ensigns there and they began to worship their pagan gods. Another reason why I don't think that works is because if Jesus is saying this is the sign, when you see this, get out, it's too late at that point. Because at that point, the Romans have already barricaded the city and built an embankment around the city so the people couldn't get out. They've already reduced the surrounding areas of Judea as well. So by the time people saw that sign, it's too late to get out. So I don't think this is talking about 70 AD. I think this is talking about the future abomination of desolation that will happen when the Antichrist commits it. That's what I think is going on here. Not to mention, as an additional point, if you look at the example of Antiochus Epiphanes and you compare that with what the Romans did, when Antiochus Epiphanes committed his abomination of desolation, he sought to impose false worship upon the Jews. When the Romans did it, it was more so an expression of their false worship than it was an imposition of it. So again, and I'll make the case even a little bit more than this, because this is important for you to understand. Matthew and Mark, I think we're looking into the future. So if we were walking through the Olivet Discourse there, I think we're looking into the future. And I say that because in both of those Gospels, Jesus is recorded as saying, quoting from Matthew 24, verse 21, "For then there will be a great tribulation, such as has not been since the beginning of the world until this time, no, nor ever shall be." I don't think that is simply hyperbole, because it is repetitively definitive. It is repetitively definitive. It's the greatest time of tribulation that the whole world has ever known. And there will be nothing like it preceding it and nothing like it after it. It's likely the time of Jacob's trouble mentioned in Jeremiah 30, verse 7. A time of distress so great that, quote, there is none like it. Furthermore, I don't think the tribulation spoken of here simply refers to Jerusalem. Remember, I'm looking at Matthew and Mark at this point, and its surrounding districts, because Jesus went on to say, I'm quoting now from Matthew 24, verse 22, "And unless those days were shortened, no flesh would be saved. But for the elect's sake, those days will be shortened." If those days went on longer, no flesh, none. That's how bad those days, which appear to be, by the way, 3.5 years, according to places like Daniel 7:25, Daniel 12:7, Revelation 12:14, and Revelation 13:5. Those 3.5 years, God cut it short for the sake of the elect. But it's so bad that if he kept it going on longer, no flesh, no human being would even last. Now, to make this point, if that's not clear enough at this point, I think that's a pretty convincing case. When you go further in Matthew's gospel, you read up to verse 29, and the text begins there by saying, immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light. The stars will fall from heaven and the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in heaven, and then all the tribes of the earth will mourn. And they, who? All the tribes of the earth, they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he will send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet, and they will gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other. That sounds worldwide, not localized. Jesus' coming is not depicted as simply potentially noticeable by some, as Josephus renders something to be, and we'll talk more about that in the future, but glorious, where all the tribes of the earth see him. And the elect will be gathered together from all over the earth at the sound of a trumpet blast, which sounds a lot like the second coming. So I would argue, when we look in Matthew and Mark's gospel, while it is a parallel text to what we're looking at in Luke, it seems there is a distinction. There, we're talking about the future and what's going to happen in Jerusalem. Well, back to Luke now. So some people might say, okay, if that's the case, then when we read Luke's gospel, we have to say, then Jesus is talking about the future here in Luke's gospel, right? I wouldn't say that. I don't think you necessarily have to come to that conclusion at all, and I'll say why. First, when you look at Luke's gospel, I think the argument is pretty clear that he's talking about 70 AD. Why am I saying that? I'm saying that because the disciples asked distinct questions as recorded in Luke's gospel when compared with Matthew's gospel. They asked, when are those things going to be? When is the temple going to be destroyed? And what's the sign of that? That was the question. And Jesus is answering that very question in verse 20. That's what he's dealing with. When you see these things, when you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, then you know that its desolation is near. I would say that was indeed the answer to their verse 7 question. But furthermore, these are additional points why I would say in Luke's gospel, we should see it, verses 20 through 24, as speaking about Jerusalem 70 AD. I would say, one, if you're Theophilus, you're like, who's Theophilus? You turn to Luke 1, you find out who he is. He was the first intended reader of Luke's gospel. If you're Theophilus, there is no hint, none whatsoever in the text. If you're reading from verse 8 to verse 24, there's no hint that all of a sudden, by the time you come to verse 20 through 24, you just jumped into the future, and Jesus, though he's speaking to his disciples, is not speaking to them at all. He's not even answering their question. He's not talking about anything that they were talking about. He just decided to talk to them, pretending like he was talking to them, but he's talking way past them, never answering their questions at all. If you're Theophilus, you have no hint at all that that's happening. You would naturally think Jesus is answering the question of his disciples. Number two, I think within Luke's gospel, it's more appropriate to see the days of vengeance that Jesus spoke about in verse 22 as referring to that generation than a future generation. I don't know if we'll get to verse 22 this morning. I think there are reasons in the whole canon of Scripture to make that case. But sticking within Luke's gospel, Luke had recorded that Jesus said, this was in Luke chapter 11, verses 50 to 51, that, quote, the blood of all the prophets, which was shed from the foundation of the world, would be required of this generation, from the blood of Abel to the blood of Zechariah, who perished between the altar and the temple. Yes, I say to you, it shall be required of this generation. So I think there's reason within Luke's gospel to say when Jesus talks about days of vengeance coming, he's talking about 70 AD. And he's talking about that generation, because that's a massive judgment that they would incur. They not only stood in the line of their fathers who rejected the prophets, but they rejected John the Baptist. They rejected the Son of God himself, Jesus Christ. And the third point for why I think we should see Luke's gospel as speaking about 70 AD Jerusalem and not the future is because when you look at verse 23 of chapter 21, Jesus said, for there will be great distress in the land and wrath upon this people. This people. Therefore, when you look at all the questions that Jesus' disciples asked. And I've been telling you these questions from the beginning. They asked essentially four questions. They said, when will these things be? When is the temple going to be destroyed? What will be the sign of that? Question number two. What will be the sign of your coming and of the end of the age? I think it's appropriate to see that Jesus answered all of their questions, and the Holy Spirit had God-intended reasons for having Luke's gospel highlight two of those answers and having Matthew and Mark highlight the other. I think according to God's sovereign prerogative, he had Luke highlight Jerusalem 70 AD, and he had Matthew and Mark highlight the future coming and the sign of Jesus' coming, the mark of the abomination of desolation in that case, the mark of Jerusalem being surrounded by armies in this case. I do think both events, in a certain prophetic, typological sense, mirror one another. Darrell Bach makes that case, saying, I think there's mirroring happening here. But I also think that God had the Holy Spirit record one aspect of Jesus' response on the Olivet Discourse here in Luke's Gospel. And he also had other aspects of Jesus' response covered in Matthew and Mark. And what you get is not contradictory, it's beautifully complementary. That would be my argument, and those are the reasons for it, why we will proceed to interpret this text as being Jerusalem 70 AD. So it appears to be the sign. This was the sign that the disciples were to be looking for. It was when Jerusalem would be surrounded by armies, then they would know that its desolation was near. The same nation that surrounded Jericho. Hebrews 11:30 uses that same word, surrounded. They now would be surrounded by Rome. This wasn't the first time Jesus said things like this. Luke chapter 19, verse 43, Jesus said, "For days will come upon you." And by the way, he said this weeping. He didn't say it capriciously. He said it weeping, "For days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment around you, surround you, and close you in on every side." And those predictive threats, they should have taken seriously. History was in some measure repeating itself. This kind of thing happened to the nation of Israel in 586 BC when Babylon came and Babylon besieged them. The Lord had said prophetically through the prophet Jeremiah, Jeremiah 6:6, this is the Lord speaking, "Cut down trees and build a mound against Jerusalem. This is the city to be punished. She is full of oppression in her midst." He likewise commanded the prophet Ezekiel in Ezekiel chapter 4, verses 1 through 4, to take a clay tablet and to depict this coming siege. History was, in a certain sense, being repeated. And it appears that history wasn't only being repeated, but history will again repeat. Leaving aside the parallels that I just referenced in the time of the Antichrist, you can go on to Revelation chapter 20. In Revelation chapter 20, verses 7 through 10, we read these words. "Now when the 1,000 years have expired, Satan will be released from his prison and will go out to deceive the nations which are in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together for battle, whose number is as the sand of the sea. They went up on the breadth of the earth, and they surrounded the camp of the saints and the beloved city." The beloved city is Jerusalem. "And fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. The devil who deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are," that's picking up from Revelation 19, "and they will be tormented day and night forever." So history did, in some measure, repeat itself in 70 AD, and history appears to, it's like it's going to repeat itself again, perhaps more than once, when you combine the Antichrist event and this event in Revelation 20. Back to Jesus' words. "When they saw Jerusalem surrounded by armies, then they were to know that its desolation was near." The word desolation is used three times in the New Testament. Every time it's used, it's in reference to the Olivet Discourse. It's in the Olivet Discourse. It means desolation, destruction, devastation. And notice that this was definite. When you see these things happening, know that this is going to happen. Desolation is near. Well, why is that important? Because many of the Jews fled into the city of Jerusalem, and we'll talk about that a little bit more in verse 21. They fled there seeking refuge. They went there thinking they would find some kind of refuge from what was happening. But Jesus said, no, you're not going to find refuge from what's happening. Maybe some of them thought, I remember when God delivered us from the Assyrians, our forefathers, when he sent one angel to strike the Assyrians who besieged us and were around us. No, it's not going to happen like that. When you see these things happen, you know that its desolation is near. It's inevitable. And if you were to ask, well, why the desolation? Like, why is that even going to happen? You could look at Luke 19:44, because they did not know the time of their visitation. God, in his mercy, had sent his son to them, and they rejected him. They didn't only reject him, they blasphemed the Holy Spirit. They mocked the Son of God, and they sought to have him killed and crucified. Hence the days of vengeance, verse 22, were coming upon them. There are other reasons, too, why this was coming upon the nation. They devoured widows' houses. Remember when we studied Luke chapter 20, verses 45 to 47? They devoured, they took advantage of those who were oppressed and most vulnerable instead of protecting them and serving them. They rejected the message of John the Baptist, Luke chapter 7, verse 30, and they rejected and conspired to kill God's Son. Those were reasons why Jerusalem was going to be desolated. Now, is there any application for us in verse 20? That's historical. That's what happened. Jesus predicted it, and it's what happened. Well, I would say first, we should marvel at Jesus' predictive accuracy. I feel like that's something that we could say like almost every week of studying the Olivet Discourse. I mean, let's not get tired of that. He spoke about this happening, and it happened right to the T. And Josephus' works well communicate that. But I will propose another application. Another application I think could be this. Imagine how you would have felt if you were the disciples and you hear Jesus tell you that the temple that you esteem and marvel at and the city that you love is going to be destroyed. Imagine how that felt. And imagine what application they would have necessarily in light of Jesus' prediction. They wouldn't want to set their heart upon that which was going to lie in ruins. So therefore, I would say by application to us, it's not wise, if you will, to set your heart upon sinking ships. What is your heart set upon? You should not get emotionally tied to sinking ships. You should remember that according to 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 10 through 13, though this world is going to be renewed, first, it's going to be destroyed by fire. Therefore, be careful that your heart is not set upon things that are perishing. You should, to use language from Hebrews chapter 11, by God's grace, looking towards a city whose builder and maker is God. If you look in Hebrews 11, you got the heroes of the patriarchal faith. They consider themselves as strangers and sojourners, and they were, quote, longing for a better country, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. It's as though they looked at the world and everything that it could have offered them, and they said, this isn't it for me. I don't want this. I'm looking towards a city whose builder and maker is God. And you can imagine the disciples when Jesus says, this city that you love, that temple that you marvel at, it's coming down. It's going to lie in ruins. They necessarily would have to say something like that. I can't set my heart and my affections upon that. I want to set my heart and my affections upon that which is eternal. I want to look towards a city whose builder and maker is God. I want to consider myself as a stranger here, as a pilgrim that's passing through. Therefore, by way of application, I would say, please, please be sure that you long for a city that's a heavenly city more than you long for a first-time home purchase or to move up in house. Be sure that you become more excited about the New Jerusalem than you become excited about New York City or Paris or any other place that, say, you might want to travel to and esteem and say, wow, it's so incredible and so beautiful. Make sure you're more excited about the coming city, the New Jerusalem. And be sure you don't place your hope upon things that are perishing. Be sure you don't place your hope upon your own physical person. And say, you know what, when I feel good and when I look good, I'm happy. No, your outer man is perishing. And I know we're frail and we're mortal, and I know those things do play into our, you know, our joy sometimes when they ought not to. But those things are perishing. The outer man, we're told, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 16, is perishing. But desire godliness which is profitable for all things, having promise for the life that is now and that which is to come. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 8. So I think there is application for us by extension when we look at Jesus' prediction to the disciples. As we continue, we see that Jesus did not only predict destruction, he gave instructions for those who believed his warning. They get the sign, verse 20. Now they get some instructions in verse 21. We read, "Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Let those who are in the midst of her depart. And let not those who are in the country enter her." That's important because while Jesus gave his disciples encouragement to endure persecution in verses 12 through 19, he didn't want them to endure Jerusalem's destruction, verse 21. He wanted them, if they saw that coming, to get out. This would be particularly pertinent for the apostles to whom he's immediately speaking. Because if you remember, when persecution came upon the early church, Acts chapter 8, verse 1, all the disciples fled when that early Jewish persecution happened. They fled, except the apostles. The apostles stayed in Jerusalem. Acts chapter 8, verse 1. Well, when Jerusalem was surrounded by armies, verse 20, those who were in Judea, so the surrounding districts of Jerusalem, they were to flee to the mountains. Those in Jerusalem were to get out. And those in the country who would likely be compelled to run into a fortified city, as I mentioned before, they had to make a choice to trust Jesus' words more than the usual acts that they would take for safety. They had to trust Jesus' words more than what they thought would be reasonable. What they thought would be reasonable would be this: I'm getting in that fortified city. They had to say, no, Jesus said, get out, run, flee, go to the mountains. Now, interestingly, historically, it appears that Christians did indeed heed Jesus' warning. The early church historian Eusebius records that the Jerusalem church left the city before the war began and settled in a town called Pella. Interestingly, when you read Eusebius' account, he says that it was an oracle that sparked them to go. Now, what kind of oracle that was, we don't know. Was it a recitation of the words that Jesus said? But Eusebius says, he doesn't elaborate upon it, but that was what sparked them to go. So this may have happened after Titus Vespasian's temporary withdrawal from Jerusalem. He had the city surrounded, by the way. Interesting part of the history. He had the city surrounded, but then he withdrew and then came back, and that's when they sieged and sacked the city. The Christians may have fled during that time. We don't know. It's relatively inconsequential, but that's still a good possibility. Whatever the case, there was a clear principle of prudence that was at work here. To use language from the Proverbs, Proverbs 22, verse 3, "The prudent see danger and take refuge, but the simple keep going and pay the penalty." Prudent see the danger and take refuge. In this case, that would have looked like those disciples saying, wait, this is happening just the way Jesus said. That's danger. We're taking refuge. Not in the city of Jerusalem. We're taking refuge in Jesus' words, and we're running for the hills. And oh my, if you think about that long enough, there is a gospel application right there. To see that warning of prudence, that when you see danger coming, you run for refuge. And just as they were to trust Jesus' word and say, Jesus' word is what I trust. And in light of his word, I see danger coming. Therefore, in light of his word, I'm running for refuge in the hills. There is gospel application there. Because every human being needs to know that there is danger coming. That if you are not reconciled to God, if you have not been forgiven of your sins, there is immeasurable, incalculable danger coming. You will stand before a God who is a consuming fire. And the judgment that we will see depicted in these verses of Jerusalem, the city, the temporal judgment, it is merely a type and a shadow of a judgment that is far worse. You are to see the danger that if you are not clothed with the righteousness of Christ, you will stand before God and you will give an account for every single one, not only of your acts, but even for your inward thoughts. You will give an account to God. You will be exposed before the God of heaven, and you will rightly, appropriately, justly be sentenced to the lake of fire. So the principle of prudence here by way of application is see the danger and run to the refuge who is Jesus Christ. Go to him. Go to the outspread arms of the Son of God who hung on a cross and say, I believe you, Jesus. I believe I deserve the danger of God's wrath. and I believe that you loved me and you gave yourself for me and you absorbed the incalculable wrath of God on my behalf. You absorbed it in its totality. For me, it would be eternal and incalculable, but you somehow immeasurably exhausted it so that I could be loved and forgiven and stand in the presence of a holy God, forgiven, not as an enemy, but as a son, not as a transgressor, but as a friend forever. See this principle of prudence. And if you haven't come to the amazing cross, if you haven't come to the amazing Son, hear the principle of prudence this morning. See the danger. Something is coming that is far worse than Jerusalem 70 AD. Far worse than that. It's a day of God's wrath, and it's a day of His judgment upon sinners who refuse to repent from their sins and believe the gospel. Run to the refuge who is Christ. It'd be like those in the days of Noah, hearing Noah preach, hearing Noah say, come into the ark, come into the ark. And those refused to take refuge in the ark, they went forward and they paid the penalty. Run into the ark who is Christ, who fully absorbed the flood of God's judgment. I would say this before closing this morning. I do think there's additional application. If you say, well, I have come to the cross. By the grace of God, I've come. And Jesus has forgiven me. God has forgiven me. I'm reconciled to God. I know that I'm loved. I know that I'm forgiven. I know that I'm set on an eternity with God and the saints and angels forever. Is there any application for me? I think there is application for you. I think there is application for me. When Jesus says here, let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains, I want you to imagine if you heard Jesus speak these words. So if you were there in Jerusalem and you see the first signs of the Roman armies gathering around, and if you believe Jesus' words, when you see that, you are fleeing, you are running with everything you have. Well, there is no command for me and you to say, how do we apply this morning? Let's all leave and run to the mountains. That would be horrible exegesis, horrible application of the text. But the same word that is used here for flee is used numerous times by the Apostle Paul in his epistles. And he's calling Christians not to flee to the mountains. He's calling them to flee from some things and to flee to some things. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 18, he tells the church at Corinth, flee sexual immorality. Run from it. Whatever form that might take, run. So if you imagine yourself in the shoes of 70 AD disciples of Jesus, and you see the first signs of the Roman armies coming and surrounding, and you're thinking, I got to get out of here. You should have that same mindset when it comes to sexual immorality in whatever form it takes. If it takes the form of pornography, if it takes the form of watching movies that you ought not to watch, if it takes the form of entertaining thoughts in your mind and there isn't a movie or isn't a computer involved, whatever it is, flee it. Run from it. Get away from it. You have to take it that serious. You have to take it that serious. Flee from it. Don't think that they should take this warning in Luke 21, verse 21, more serious than you should take the warning in 1 Corinthians 6, 18. Don't make that mistake. Paul goes on in 1 Corinthians 10, verse 14, and he says, flee idolatry. Get away from idolatry. I mean, John would say at the end of his epistle, and you know how John closed his epistle, first epistle, little children, keep yourselves from idols. It wasn't just an Old Testament problem. It was a New Testament problem. And granted, today it may take different forms. We don't really see people around here bowing before Baal and Ashtoreth, but we do see people worshiping money and worshiping provision and worshiping pleasure. We do see those things. Flee from idolatry. Get away from it. As somebody who believes the gospel and believes you've been forgiven and believes you've been empowered by the Holy Spirit of God with a changed nature and new desires, flee from those things. Paul says in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 10 through 11, to flee the love of money. If you sense that in you, if you sense that in you, in whatever shape or form it takes, you like counting it too much, you got Scrooge McDuck syndrome, you like looking at the bank account, oh, that gets me fired up, right? Oh, look at that bank account, got an app. Flee from it. Be aware of it. Just say, I want to get away from it. Not because I'm trying to earn my salvation, but because I've been graciously granted salvation. I want to run from it. Paul says to Timothy, flee youthful lusts. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 22. Those things, Timothy, those lusts that are often associated with youth, get away from them, similar to the 1 Corinthians 6:18. It's interesting, though, right after that, he doesn't only tell Timothy to flee from things, which is so biblically appropriate. He tells him to pursue other things. He told Timothy at the end of verse 22 to run after, to pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace. Right? So it's not just like, oh, I don't want to not do things. I want to run towards things as a forgiven, loved, blood-bought Christian. I want to run towards walking in righteousness and exhibiting it by God's grace. I want to walk in faith. I want to ask God, help me believe you more. Help me believe your word more. What does it look like? I'm not Enoch, but what does it look like for me to walk with you in faith, even as he walked with you in faith and had this testimony that he pleased God, Hebrews 11:5. What does it look like for me to do that now in 2017? I want to pursue love. I'm not satisfied with how much I love the body of Christ. I'm not satisfied with how much I love Christ. I'm not satisfied with how much I love to reach out to the gospel to the lost. I want to love more. God, help me. And I want to pursue peace. I want to be a peacemaker. So you aren't called to flee into the mountains of Judea, but you are called to flee the things that God tells you to flee, and you are called to pursue the things that God tells you to pursue. So I do think there's application for us. I don't think it's by coincidence that the same word is used and affords us an opportunity of application by extension this morning. One additional piece of instruction and encouragement as it relates to fleeing, by the way, comes from James. James wrote, "Humble yourself before God, resist the devil, and he," same word, "will flee from you." Humble yourself. Subject yourself to the will of God. Don't exalt yourself. Humble yourself before him. Resist the devil and his temptations. And by God's grace, you let the Lord handle it, and he will flee from you, the devil. Jesus gave instructions for flight. And coming in verse 22 is the first reason he gives for that, after the whole prediction of the surrounding of Jerusalem. But Lord willing, we'll come to that next week. Let's pray. Father, oh, we thank you for your word. I thank you for the reality of your word, Lord, and the way that the words that your son spoke are perfectly veracious, perfectly truthful. I thank you for your predictive accuracy that you display for us finite men, so that we can marvel at a God whose understanding is infinite. And to think you who have infinite understanding, who make known the end from the beginning, and you know us inside out, and you know our frailty, you know our sins, yet you would send your son to die for sinners like us. Thank you for such amazing love. Father, if there's anyone in this place this morning who has not fled to the refuge who is Jesus Christ, and prudently saw the danger of your appropriate wrath coming, may this be a morning, Lord, an afternoon where you beget repentance and faith, and thereby the forgiveness of sins when exercised. Oh, Lord, may it be. For those who do know you, Heavenly Father, I pray afresh this morning, while we cannot flee to the mountains of Judea, or at least we ought not to, Father, I pray that you'd help us to flee those things that you call us to flee from, in whatever stage of temptation they may assail us. And I pray, Heavenly Father, you'd help us to pursue the things that you tell us to pursue, not trying to gain or merit anything from you, but as a response to the infinite, immeasurable grace that you've displayed towards us now and that you commit to display to us for all of eternity, according to Ephesians 2:7. What an amazing God you are. Thank you for your word, and we pray these things this morning in Jesus' name. Amen.